diving right into the text, or I could tell you a Rachel story. Which would you guys like?
We want a Rachel story.
We got to vote for, we'll start with the Rachel story then. So a couple days ago, and yes, by the way, if you guys said dive right in, I would have dived right in, and you would have been void of the Rachel story. A couple days ago, I was really kind of struggling with a text and what I was going to do with it. In fact, I even sent out a text messages to several people asking, what do I do about this? And Pastor Harry got one, and some other people got one, and I'm going to eventually pool all their wisdom together and present to you some of the research. Here's the problem, though. I wanted to quote a particular pastor I didn't like. No, not our associate pastor. I love him. Okay, there was another pastor that I wanted to quote who has horrible books out, bad theology. In fact, he has been officially labeled by the Evangelical Society of America as being committed heresies. Okay, so not a good pastor to quote, but he said something profound, and I loved it, and it was very insightful. So I wanted to quote him. And I'm talking to my wife going, how do I quote him without really talking too bad about him? But I want people to know not to research him too much. I don't want them to read him thinking that I support his views because it wasn't good views. And so she said, I know. You could say that even a blind pig could find an acorn every now and then. It's kind of the thing that, well, she said a few phrases, but you mean that one? She goes, yeah. And I said, well, the problem with that phrase is that it's actually inaccurate because a pig finds their acorns by their nose. So a blind pig can find an acorn just as well as a seeing pig. In fact, that statement, a blind pig can find an acorn, is really a statement that says, I'm just as capable as the next guy, regardless of any apparent disabilities. And that's not the type of message I wanted to communicate about this pastor. And so what she ended up doing was she ended up saying this great, clever, funny, witty phrase. I'm not going to tell you it. I'm going to save it for in the sermon. So she said this great, hilarious, funny, witty, clever, smart phrase. And I heard it and I went, I didn't laugh at first. I had to think about it for a minute. And I started chuckling and I go, wow, that's like a good marinade. The more that sits with me, the funnier it gets and the more clever it gets. That's really witty. Where'd you hear that from? And she said, what do you mean, where'd I hear it from? Can't I come up with something like that on my own? And I said, no, it just is so funny and so clever and so witty. And she said, what? You don't think I'm funny, clever, or witty? You don't like your wife like that? And I'm like, no, that's not what I mean at all. Okay, have you ever gotten, here's my point now, have you ever gotten into that place in life where you just owed someone an apology? You just said or did something that you later look back on and you go, yeah, I'm going to have to apologize here because there's no way of really fixing this. Okay. Have you ever been there? You said something, did something that you're just like, I'm going to have to deal. Now, have you ever tried to weasel out of that responsibility of apologizing? Have you ever tried to weasel out where you don't have to? You tried to defend yourself or doing a real quick, clever, wordy turnaround to make it really seem like it was a compliment all along. Okay, and so that way you don't have to apologize. Have you ever tried to skirt apologizing? And I know we've all have at some point or another. This is where we find ourselves in Acts 16, is we find ourselves to where some Roman magistrates, some Roman leaders, mistreated, mishandled, and really did a criminal action against Paul and Silas. They abused them, whipped them, denied them trial, things that allowed them to, all the leaders to go into jail because of their brutality and denying a Roman citizen trial. And so Paul's going to end up requesting from them an apology, and they're going to have to deal with that. So that's going to be our text and what we're going to be looking at. So let's go ahead and dig right into Acts 16 with Paul and Silas. And what I want to do is I'd like to kind of start with a recap. It might be a new word for your vocabulary, but it's alliterative and it's nice. And so we're going to start with a recap of what has happened with Philippi thus far. So Paul and his BFF, his best friend forever, Barnabas, were in a fight over another guy that had deserted them in the past. They didn't want to include him. And so Paul and Barnabas split ways. And Paul grabs a new guy named Silas, a guy whose name is based off of Silvanus, which is a pagan god. So not the best guy to really have as your right-hand man, but nonetheless, he's a Christian, so let's work with it. So he grabs Silas, and he says, let's go ahead and go. And they end up trying to figure out where to go. And this Holy Spirit is telling them not here, not there. And they're traveling for 500 miles for the Holy Spirit to say no, for all their ministry attempts to just fail, for every door to close. And they're traveling for hundreds of miles, and it's no. And they're losing, and nothing's happening. And it looks like they don't know what's happening. Finally, they end up in the into Greece, and they end up into the Philippi region. And they're like, maybe this will be where God wants us to start. After all, God gave us a vision, a dream that has a guy saying, come to Macedonia, come here and help us here. And so they go to the Macedonia area, go to like the Grand Rapids of that area, a great thriving metropolis, the first of places to go. And they find out that there's no church there. And they find out there's no synagogue there. And they find out there's no Christian Jewish men there. It's all women. And that's it. There is just a group of ladies who are just kind of gathering together for prayer. And that's all he has to work with. One of the ladies happens to be rich. And so they try to start a plant there. And they're working the best they can with it. Meanwhile, there's a demon-possessed girl walking around telling everyone, these people are talking about God. These people are talking about God. And it ticked Paul off so much, he turned around and cast the demon out of her, to which then the owners said, you wrecked our investment. She fortune told for us. She told us a lot of neat things and was able to fortune tell business investments. We made a lot of money, which by the way shows that it is maybe possible to use demonic powers for fortune telling type abilities. You'll go to hell for it, so it's not worth it. But nonetheless, that power seems to be available out there somewhere. And so they're working with this. They cast the demon out. The people say, you did this bad. You wrecked our investment. They beat them, flogged them, ripped skin off their backs by beating them with rods and throw them in the prison. Okay, this is the start of the Philippian church. Rough start. Okay, just think about that whole storyline there. That is a church plant starting with just defeat wrapped all around it, right? That's just horrible, rough start. And that is, by the way, what it's like. It's like that in life. It's like that when you start new ministries. It's like that when you try to make changes in your life personally. If you say, yeah, I'm not following God, but I'm going to start following God, it seems like everything gets difficult. It seems like everything that can go wrong does. It seems like anything that can hold you back from changing your life or starting a ministry or making changes, everything that can hold you back happens. And then comes the temptation to want to quit. Comes a temptation to want to give up, or it comes a temptation just to go back the way things were, old habits, old ways of doing things. I was trying to quit these addictive behaviors, but now everything's going bad. I used that behavior in the past to try to emotionally stabilize myself. It's my stress relief. It's how I celebrate. It's how it makes me feel better when I'm sad. It's my distraction from boredom or whatever the case is. And we go back to those old behaviors, back to those old sins, and then we find ourselves just ruined. And that's what's happening to Paul and Silas, is there's a spiritual war that's happening that is trying to stop the plant of Philippi from taking off. So everything that could possibly go wrong is going wrong. And so now Paul and Silas are in jail. And how do they respond while they're in jail? Do they respond by pity partying, complaining, going back to old sins? No. Surprisingly enough, and surprisingly to the jailers and to the Roman soldiers, they sing. They start singing praises to God, and that confuses everyone, because who sings praises to God when everything goes wrong? Because surely if God could do something, he would, and he can, and he's not. So something seems to be wrong, and you're praising him for everything going wrong? To Paul and Silas, the answer is, yeah, we're praising him for everything that's going wrong, because it's not about the comfort of life, it's about serving God. And so that was their emphasis, that was their direction in life. And so then an earthquake happened, which is common in the region of Philippi. They're like the California of the Middle East. They just get earthquakes. That's what you would expect to happen. But this earthquake was neat in that it happened to shake the jail and freed all the prisoners. Did the prisoners leave? No, because Paul and Silas were such great worship leaders, they stayed for the rock concert. This is a good show. So they stayed, and they enjoyed the music, and they enjoyed the time, but they stayed. And so they end up leading the jailer, the owner of the jail, and his whole family to Christ. An amazing thing, an amazing thing. That's where we get to be left off now. That's where we left off last week, was now what happens? The jailer is led to Christ. His family's led to Christ. They've been baptized. Everything's awesome. Now what? What happens from that point forward? Well, what ends up happening is there is a very urgent desire. This is weird. There's an urgent desire to free Paul and Silas. Check it out. This is from verses 35 to 37. Here's how it reads. If you have your Bibles, read along with it. It says, when daylight came, okay, so the next day, the rooster's crowing and the daylight has come, the chief magistrates sent the police to say, release those men. This is an immediate type of command. Do not delay. Go there now. Release Paul and Silas. That's those men. It's not the whole jail. It's specifically those two men, Paul and Silas. The jailer reported these words to Paul. The magistrates have sent orders for you to be released. So come out now and go in peace. How was Paul and Silas treated? Badly. You think they just wanted to say, let the bygones be bygones? I don't think so. It's not going to be so simple. So they say, but Paul said to them, they beat us in public without a trial. Although we are Roman citizens and they threw us in jail. This criminal offense right there. Everyone who beat them and threw them in jail is criminal offense. Deserved to be tried, beaten, stripped of their position of authority, even thrown into jail. Okay, that's the Roman procedure on that in Roman law. Okay, so Paul says, they violated the law here. They beat us without a trial, even though we're citizens. And now, are they really going to smuggle us out secretly? I don't think so. Certainly not. On the contrary, let them come themselves and escort us out. Let them come here to the jail, take us by the hand, and walk us out of here. That's Paul's request here. And so that leads to a couple of interesting questions. Number one, first question I have is, why the urgency to release Paul and Silas? That's interesting. Okay, and there's been several viewpoints as to why they might want to release Paul and Silas so urgently, and I'm going to share them with you and share with you some of the problems of these views, but they are interesting and they have possibilities. The first one is that it could be that the Roman people feared upsetting the Jews, that they feared ticking them off, and they didn't want an uprising of the Jews. And so they said, you know what? We got a couple of their leaders in captivity. We don't want to upset the church, so let's go ahead and release them, lest we have a riot on our hands. That's one common viewpoint. There's a problem with this viewpoint. What type of church is in Philippi? There isn't one. What type of Jewish population is in Philippi? There really isn't one. Just a couple of ladies. Okay, so is there, and already in Rome, they had already excommunicated Jews out of a big upheaval that had happened, kicked them all out of the city. Other Roman colonies were all like, if there's Jews here, if they give us any stink, we're kicking them out of here. So are they afraid of upsetting Jews? No. They're just as nervous about upsetting Jews as the Germans were in World War II. Okay, so they're not concerned at all. So I don't think this view holds a lot of weight, not much at all. There was another view, though, that is very popular amongst commentators and scholars, and that view is that they had learned about the citizenship of Paul and Silas, and that citizenship freaked them out and made them very, very nervous, that they had discovered that they actually did belong in their great little fraternity, and all of them gathering together, toga, toga, okay. Animal House, yeah. Anyway, so that they found out they were citizens, and then they were like, oh my gosh, they're citizens. This is a criminal offense. Let's get them out of here. Problem though. They did not find out about the citizenship of Paul and Silas until after Paul mentions it, which happens later, verse 38. Then the police reported these words to the magistrates, and they were afraid when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, which means they did not know previously. So that view doesn't quite work. Maybe they suspected the possibility, but it doesn't seem to lend itself to that type of an issue. So I'm going to have to say that view number two just doesn't quite hold the mustard. So here's another view I ran across. This other view said that maybe after a night's sleep, they realized that they just made a really bad choice, and therefore they felt regret and remorse. Yes, that's a real photo of a real cat in a real jar. Now, that's a cat that says, maybe this wasn't such a good idea after all. Okay, and this is a third view, that maybe, like, I don't know, you guys have probably all been there, that you made choices, you made decisions, and you wake up in the morning and you go, you know, maybe that wasn't the best choice in the world. And maybe that is what's going on here. But there's also a problem with this view in that it doesn't seem to allow for the urgency and smuggling. It allows for, okay, we need to correct the situation. It allows for that type of an issue to say, yeah, okay, we acted too harshly upon these guys, so they cast out a demon out of a girl. Yeah, we shouldn't have done it so far, so we're sorry. Let's go ahead and release them and let bygones be bygones. But there is an urgency there. And isn't there urgency in the text? Isn't Paul claiming that they're trying to smuggle them out? They're trying to secretly dispose of them? You know, it doesn't seem to quite line up. So it makes me wonder if there happens to be a fourth view that is possible. And I ran across more than four views, by the way, more than just these three, but these are the three most common that I shared with you. So allow me to kind of create a new view. Okay, I'm going to take a whole bunch of different views I ran across. I'm going to try to play bartender with them. Okay, I'm going to put them all into one big blender and make a tornado, okay, and add a little bit of sweetness to it, maybe a little umbrella on top, and say, here we go, let's drink on this for a while and see what we think. So I'm going to combine several views together, including one of the ones that I did share with you already. And I'm going to try to blend it all. So here's how this view kind of looks. I don't have a clever graphic for it. I apologize because my views aren't so simple as that, and I don't want to make fun of my view. Not when I think I'm right. So the view that I would like to present would be that they realized they had a regret, they realized they did an error, but not in that we were too harsh, but in that they recognized that they responded out of emotional haste and they forgot to investigate whether there was citizenship or not, because that's required. You don't have to have a trial if they're not Roman citizens, but you have to find out if they are Roman citizens or not. And so they realized that, you know, maybe they were sleeping at night, they woke up and they go, you know, we were really angry and we responded very emotionally, but we never stopped to actually follow proper procedures. So therefore, we never really said, are they Roman citizens? We just assumed that because they were Jews, they weren't. But there are Jewish Roman citizens, because any Jew that's born in a Roman colony becomes a Roman citizen, kind of like anybody who's born in America becomes an American citizen, even if the parents aren't. Okay, so it's that type of a scenario. And so they might have woken up. Again, this is all hypothesizing, because there's no text that says, and they felt sad. Okay, we don't have that text anywhere. So I'm having to hypothesize, create a little theory here. And so my thought is that they realized they didn't do it appropriately. They didn't do it to the letter of the law. And therefore, there is a chance that they could be citizens. Therefore, they're like, you know what? We made a mistake. We pushed this through too fast. We should have been more slow. Now what's done is done. There's nothing we can do about it. And if they happen to might be Roman citizens, we could be in trouble. So let's go ahead and just get them out of here. We don't want to take them further into court because then it would come up. We don't want to take them further into any type of issue because it could eventually arise that we did something inappropriately. We don't want to have that be indicated. Now, this is something that's obviously unique to Roman, right? Because America never does anything out of haste, not realizing they didn't follow the procedures appropriately. Okay, so this is a common theme amongst politicians, to just be really passionate and try to push things through, not stopping and asking about procedure. And here's the thing. Have you ever done that you said or did something out of just haste, out of the passion of the moment, and then later you looked back and you say, man, I just did that wrong. I said the wrong things, I did the wrong things, and now I wish I could just pretend. Yeah, people are saying it like it never happened. I wish I could just pretend like it never happened. How do I go to work pretending that I never did what I did in the office? How do I go back to school pretending like I never said what I said or that I didn't do what I did? How do I pretend like it never happened? How do I do that? Maybe I'll just switch schools. Maybe I'll just switch jobs. Maybe I'll ask for a transfer. And people do that, don't they? Have people ever quit their job because of embarrassment and humiliation because of a poor decision? Or maybe they drop out of school, or maybe they transfer schools. Maybe they do different things because they're just embarrassed or afraid or humiliated, or they just don't know how to handle it. They want to weasel out of that apology. They want to weasel out of saying, yeah, I'm a failure and I screwed up and don't look at me, look at Christ. You know, people don't want to say that. And so they try to weasel out. And here's the thing, and this is the reality of this. Our actions and our words are like dandelion seeds. Once you blow into it, it's gone. And you cannot, no matter how hard you try, gather up the seeds and glue them back on. Okay, and in fact, we could even do this if you ever wanted. Wouldn't it be fun? We'd just all go outside, all grab a dandelion, all blow into it, and then say, okay, everybody, fetch. That would be great. Some of the people here with a cane just kind of, you know, that could be a lot of fun to watch. I know I'm cruel and sadistic. I'm sorry. But, but it would be fun, you know. But it's just that's it, though. Okay, you can't undo. You can't change the unchangeable past. So what do? Do you just pretend? We just won't talk about it. But all the while, then, what's happening with that? It sits in the back of your mind for days, weeks, even months, wondering if they're thinking about it, wondering if they really know, wondering if they remember as well as you remember, wondering if they're thinking of, wondering if their comments that they make are referring back to that moment or if it's innocently referring to something in the present. And constantly is coming up in your mind over and over again. You got to do something about it. You got to recognize that the seeds are gone and make the statement. But how do we go about doing that? And so this is the situation that now the Roman leaders are in. What do we do? He could be a citizen. And then they find out he is. They knew that they could have been in the wrong, but they didn't know just how much in the wrong they really were. And it just got worse. It'd be kind of like if we end up saying or doing something that's inappropriate at work just to find out that the person we did it to was the boss's son. And we go, you know, it was bad that I treated an employee that way. Oh, that was the boss's son? Oh, snap, this got worse. Just when I thought that this could just maybe be bygones, no, it got worse. And they're dating my sister? You know, and they're getting engaged? Oh, no. Okay, and it just keeps getting worse, right? And so it's that type of a scenario. That's what they're working with. And so now has to come this, how do we move forward into the future in peace and freedom without being weighted by these issues of the past? How do we deal with that? And so Paul offers a great way out, and he says, come here to my face and escort me out of this jail. You want me released? Don't just walk, undo the chains and let me walk out. You come here and you walk me out. You come here and you admit your wrongdoing to me by coming to me, taking me by the hand and say, here, sir, let me show you the door. Okay, that's his request to them. And so an apology is awarded to Paul and Silas, and the apology is accepted by Paul and Silas. And this is very curious. I find this very curious indeed. Check this out. It goes on, and it says in verse 39, so they, the Roman magistrates, leaders, they came and apologized to Paul and Silas. I will hand you this. I respect these men. I do not respect how they treated Paul and Silas. I do not respect their belief in God, but I do respect that they're man enough, that they're mature enough, respectable people enough to actually go up to someone to their face. They didn't tweet it. They didn't blog it. They didn't put it on Facebook. Okay. They went up to their face, and they didn't just say, here's your chains, get out of here. What did they do? apologized. I respect a little bit these men. Hats off to them. Okay? So they apologized to them and escorting them out, doing what Paul requested that they do, escorting them out, they urged them to leave town. This is interesting. They say, you know, we're sorry, we mistreated you. Now get out of town. Don't let us ever see your face here again. That's the attitude. That's what's going on here. They apologize. I'm sorry, we mistreated you. We shouldn't have handled it this way. Now get out of here and don't come back. Okay, it's that don't let the door hit you with the good Lord split you type Southern mentality. Okay, it's get out of here. So they urged them to leave town after leaving the jail. Paul and Silas are kind of nonchalant about leaving town. You notice this? They don't just leave. They're like, okay, we'll leave town by our own route. We're going right instead of left, and we're going to go pay a friend a visit. They go to where the church is gathering. They go to Lydia's house, the lady, the rich lady who dealt with purple linens, the financial backbone of the church of Philippi there. They came to Lydia's house where they saw and encouraged the brothers, and then they departed. So they went to the church and they said, hey, church, we're out, we're free, we're leaving, but we're free. Now, I want you to notice something. What type of pronoun is used regarding Paul and Silas here? But the word they, not the word we. We was used earlier in the text when they approached the whole Philippian area, when they came to that town, because this whole book of Acts is written by a guy named Luke. And he used the word we because he is saying that Paul and Silas and Timothy and himself were going there. And then he says they left, which means who stayed? Luke. Luke stayed. So odds are Luke stayed because he shifts from the they, from the we to the they. He doesn't include himself here. And he includes himself every time he's with Paul, he says we. Later he reunites with Paul and they get on a ship and the ship goes shipwrecked. And then Luke says, and we all lost our minds. And including himself in that matter. And then he talks about they, meaning Paul and Silas. So he includes himself when appropriate. So he says they left, which is fine. Is Luke breaking any laws? No. Who was told to leave the town? Paul and Silas. Yeah. Can Luke stay? Absolutely. The ruling wasn't to him. It wasn't gather all your friends and get out of here. It was Paul and Silas leave. So Paul and Silas are leaving. They're being respectful men. They're respecting the authority that's there. Even though they may not like it, they're respecting it, and they're leaving town. Luke, meanwhile, says, I'm going to hang out for a while. Lydia's single, and she's hot. Okay, that may not be the situation, but and she's wealthy, which is a great combination here, you know. And something may be wrong with her heart, which means even if I don't like her, no. So who knows what's all going on? But Luke stays. Okay, Luke stays. So Paul and Silas, and they're the ones that are absolutely leaving. Now, here's what is absolutely curious to me. And this really just, this is where I started asking questions of other people, because I just was trying to wrap my brain around this. Paul and Silas, Roman citizens, right? Right. Roman citizens. They were mistreated, whipped and beaten in public, stripped naked, thrown into a prison, into stockades, which never is to happen to a Roman citizen. Never are they to be ever beaten and thrown into the stockades. Even if found guilty, that's not how they're treated because they're Roman citizens. And every Roman citizen is required to have a trial, which was absolutely denied. To deny the Roman trial, to deny or to even mistreat and misuse and have inappropriate conduct is a criminal offense, which means those who are imprisoned in such conditions have the full legal authoritative right to do a lawsuit, to press charges against those who did the injustice. And do Paul and Silas do this? No. They accept the apology and they accept the command to leave town. This is weird. I don't know if I would do that myself. I started thinking about this. If someone didn't treat me like an American citizen and they violated every one of my civil rights, wouldn't I be in the total justified position to say this was wrong, I'm going to sue? Would be totally justified legally to do so. And most people would even say morally and ethically allowed to do so. That is appropriate to do that. But Paul and Silas don't. And this is weird. And I start racking my head around this. Why did they not continue to pursue charges? Because if Paul and Silas were mistreated, other people are being mistreated. This isn't the first time this has happened, and probably not the last time. And a lawsuit pressing charges could remove these violators from their position, allowing for hopefully better people to get into those positions that won't mistreat people. So it would be a great social justice, wouldn't it? So it seems weird that they don't do it. It seems weird to me. And then I started thinking, well, maybe it's just a cultural issue. Maybe I'm coming at it from an American mindset, which is a very entitled mindset. I'm entitled to my rights. I'm entitled to law. I'm entitled to Constitution. I'm entitled to all of this. This is mine, and I get to defend it and fight for it, when really we're not entitled to anything that's given to us. And so maybe it's that mindset. Maybe the Eastern mindset isn't quite the same way. Maybe Eastern cultures aren't so entitled. Maybe they don't sue for everything. Because Americans will sue for everything. Well, we'll sue if someone spills coffee, if we spill coffee on ourselves and the coffee's too hot. Real picture of a case that happened where a lady was awarded $2.9 million from McDonald's because the coffee was so hot that she spilled on her own lap in her car that burnt her leg. So she sues McDonald's and won because the coffee was too hot. I don't know about you, but if I'm going to want coffee, guess what it better be? I'm not asking for coffee-flavored ice cream here. I want coffee. You know, it's a hot drink. If I'm going to order it, that's what I want, okay? Now, I myself am not a coffee drinker, so I'm not in this position. But nonetheless, this is what happened. Someone in California sued the Oreo company because they had trans fat in the Oreo company, and they felt that trans fat was unhealthy, so they sued Oreos.
And they won?
No, they didn't. They got thrown out. Cookie Monster was the judge, so it just didn't. it just didn't work.
oh, sorry, meat ain't evidence, huh?
and then there are other people that will actually threaten to sue just because you're making the fun of the size of their hands, and so on and on. The issues are going. That our culture is the type that says, we're going to sue, we're going to sue, we're going to sue. And we're a major lawsuit society. But that does then bring the question, is there a difference? And if there is, what is that difference between justice and vengeance? At what point are we actually pursuing justice? And at what point are we actually pursuing revenge? When is it something that is actually appropriate morally and ethically? And when is it very, very personal? And it gets hard to define where that line is, because sometimes the pursuit of justice is very personal because you're personally involved. And sometimes the issue of revenge might actually be a social justice issue. And so how do we know the difference between the two? How do we know that we are actually pursuing justice or we're pursuing a personal vendetta? You know, how do we know if we are the V or the Batman? You know, how do we know what we're dealing with here? And so this is where I started doing my research, and I started going all over the place. So I decided I'll start with secular legal ethics. I wanted to start there, just to kind of see what the standard American understanding is regarding the legal approach to justice versus vengeance. And I ran across this from a secular ethics report that said that true justice is motivated by the desire to establish a better society, where revenge is motivated by the desire to harm. That is kind of one of the ways they try to look at it. Are you trying to better society, or are you trying to harm an individual? And this right here, by the way, is the big battle cry for people trying to remove capital punishment and certain types of imprisonments, because you're harming the criminal at that point, especially capital punishment, because that leads to, you know, their death. And that's not very healthy, you know, for the individual. And so they start saying, therefore, that capital punishment is actually a vengeance, not social justice. But yet I find that capital punishment is biblically appropriate in certain cases, and therefore it is about social justice, and it is about punishment fitting the crime, and it is not a vengeance issue. And so it is kind of interesting to see that this doesn't really help all too much. So I decided to take it further, to go beyond just the legalities of it and all out of the philosophers that are out there. And so I decided to take a more of a theological approach. So I decided to send out a message to to Reverend John Herrick, our associate pastor, to try to help me out here. I found the most flattering picture I could. So via the beauty of texting, he gave me this. If it's for the Lord, it's justice. If it's for personal satisfaction, it's vengeance. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that. Although I would have to ask, what if we're personally satisfied with justice? Okay. Then does that mean that it's, I mean, where's the lie? So I appreciate it. Here it comes. Yeah, which shows there is bleed over that is there. It's hard. There's a fine, fine line between the two. It's kind of like love, you know? It's a fine, fine line between love and a waste of your time. And it's a fine, fine line between justice and vengeance. And how do we know which side we're on? So I decided to continue on, and I inquired further. So I went to our soon-to-be approaching the issue of Deacon Alan Driscoll, and I asked him what, and I wish he would have been here today. That would have been just really funny. still funny, because it's on YouTube. He'll see it later. So I asked him. I said, "Now, what would be the difference between the two here?" And so he offered this. Revenge is rooted in evil, but justice is rooted in good. And so I appreciated that. That took Pastor Herrick and brought it to a next step, which is great to see that we have very wise people within our congregation. And I'm really excited to be part of this congregation because we have so much wisdom here. And it's awesome. I like this, actually. But here's the thing. There's still a push I can give on this. Have you ever did anything that was evil but you were convinced was good? Have you ever tried justifying wrong actions because you thought you were in the right? Has that ever happened in society where a group of people or even a government thought that they were on the moral right and were doing the good of humanity, but what they did was an atrocious evil? You see, the evil and good are subjective categories sometimes. And so I want to take for the Lord so we can say maybe something like justice is rooted in Scripture, where revenge is rooted outside. Maybe we could do something like that. But so you can see, it's just, this is a real mess, isn't it? It's a real mess. So then I kept going. I wanted more. So I went outside of our little circle, and I ran across another response that I thought was absolutely phenomenal by a person by the name of Rob Bell. And this is very, very insightful, but I really don't recommend his readings. This is where my wife said that I'm like, man, he said something wonderful. This is awesome. And she said, I guess even Rob Bell can find hay in a haystack. And I was like, that's funny. That's clever. Who said it? You know, and so here's what Rob Bell said, and I love this quote. It's one of my favorite quotes on the issue. Rob Bell said this, someone wrongs us, we rarely want to do the same thing back. Why? Because we want to do something more harmful. When someone insults us, our instinct is to search for words more insulting. Revenge always escalates. Love that. Love that. Social justice wants to level the playing field and keep it consistent to the law, but revenge wants to escalate. It wants to move it beyond what is appropriate, move it beyond that. And I absolutely love that. I think that is a phenomenal statement that is given by him in that. And so here's kind of the thing, is that when we look at justice versus vengeance, could it be that something about pursuing the courts and pressing charges would have tipped this pendulum to push it more toward vengeance than it would have been social justice? Because after all, Paul and Silas said what? We want you not just to have us smuggled out of here. We want you to admit you were wrong by apologizing to us, by coming down here in person and escorting us out of the jail. Okay, that is a type of royal treatment. Did the people admit to that? Absolutely. To go further, Thank you for escorting us out. Thank you for apologizing. Thank you for admitting that you're wrong. And we want to wreck your families because we want you to lose your job forever. And we want your families to lose their homes and your kids to be homeless. And we want to make sure you never have a job again and that you're a beggar on the street. And we want to make sure that you are personally hurt like we are hurt. Do you see where this begins to change the attitude? Pressing charges begins tipping the scales. It becomes more vengeful than it is about justice. And so I believe that to pursue further would have been seeking their harm. It would have escalated it. It would have been about hurting them than being for their benefit. Especially since they've already honestly admitted their wrongdoing by traveling the distance, showing up, and escorting them out and apologizing. And so that is some of what I think is the battle here between justice and vengeance. And it all seems to kind of lightly, slightly hinge on this one leather little issue that we'll talk about in closing, and that is the issue of apologizing. Because I'll tell you what, it is amazing how hard something like this is. It is amazing how hard it is to honestly go to someone face to face and fully apologize. I want you to note that wording. Now, I didn't just say apologize, did I? I said what? Fully apologize, which means there's more to it than saying sorry, or more to it than saying my bad. I want to smack people that talk that type of grammar. You know, but there's more to it than that, okay? More, I say it myself. I can, you know. But here's the thing. Here's what it is about apologizing. Apologizing is more than just saying sorry. There's something much more to it, and I would like to walk you through it. Okay, I would like to walk you through it. What it means to apologize. This will be kind of a Christian counseling perspective. You guys are all get to be clients. Group therapy. You ready? Here it is on what it means to actually apologize to someone. It's going to be a couple steps to it. Number one, first, you need to avoid the who started it approach. Okay, avoid that. Don't talk about who started it. It is of no consequence who started it. So-and-so said it first. Well, does that mean you're right in saying something worse back? Because you're doing what? Escalating it. Just because they wronged you doesn't mean that vengeance is allowed. Because vengeance belongs to whom and whom only? God. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Okay, it's his role to deal with vengeance because he is the truly holy one with the whole motives and the holy motives. He's the one that establishes the law. He's the one that reigns, and he's the one who is the judge of judges. He is the one who's the king of kings. It's his department, not ours. So we can't just go around saying who started it. Here's how this usually sounds, by the way, when we do the who started approach, just putting it down to practical levels for you. It's usually when he says, well, they make me so mad. Ever said that? They make me so mad. Well, here's the funny thing. No one makes you do anything. You're not a robot. No one makes you mad. You're just responding angry at this moment out of your own choice because you don't have remote control. I'm going to tick off my wife. Now, granted, we understand what buttons people have, and we push them intentionally to upset people because we understand we're all weak in that area. But nonetheless, we choose our responses. No one makes you anything. Okay, so you're choosing to get mad about. And the question is it appropriate to get mad? Because sometimes it is. Is it appropriate to get mad? Is it appropriate to say, I am choosing to be mad about this because? That's different. But to say, you make me. In other words, what you're saying is, my response out of anger is your fault. And you're shifting that blame. You're saying, you started it. Therefore, it's your fault. Or they might say, well, if you hadn't, I wouldn't have. Not true. It is not cause effect. So we have to first avoid the who started it approach, okay? In other words, take responsibility for your thoughts, your emotions, your actions, your words. Take responsibility for it all. So avoid who started it. And then comes the hard part about apologizing, and that is that apology, if it's going to be a full apology, has to involve confession. And this is where it gets hard. And I'm telling you, it is harder for Baptists and Protestants in general than any other group. And I believe because the Catholics have that confessional that you go to, and you go to that priest, and you sit in a little box, and you go, forgive me, I have sinned, blah. Okay, and you go through all of that. And what happens is we look at that, and we say, we want nothing to do with that, so confession's bad. But now we're cutting our apology shorts. Now we're completely losing the whole issue of confessing to one another when we've done a wrongdoing. Because confession is biblical. Confession is appropriate. Confession is holy. We need to confess. After all, if you even want to come to accept Christ as Savior, what does it take? Okay? So a confession is necessary. It's not a Catholic thing. It's a God thing. Okay, so when it comes to confession, this is how confession looks within an apology. This is an apologetic confession. You ready? Okay, here's how this works. It's four simple steps, really, really easy. And by the way, I work hard, and I don't do it perfectly, but I do work hard at trying to do this with my wife when I do something wrong. Okay, I try to go through these four steps. And sometimes I do it well, sometimes I do not. And she'll contest that, yeah, he's done that before, absolutely. He didn't do it last week, but he did it after that, and it's okay. Okay, but so it's hard. It takes practice. You got to put it into habit. Step number one, you start with, I did, and you fill in the blank. Okay, I did, and you fill in the blank. Don't say, I did blank. It does no good, okay? Go up, you know, you have to go up to someone to apologize. Go apologize. Okay, I did blank. You did what? Blank. You know, no, okay. I did. And then you say whatever it is you did and be specific. And don't you dare try to make it a blame shift. Okay? Don't you dare try to say, I did this because you first. Or I did this, but if you hadn't. Okay? I did this because you made me so. Okay? Don't be a wuss about it. I did blank. Period. Done. Nothing else. Okay? I did blank. Don't do if. Confessions. If confessions are, well, if I hurt you, I'm sorry. if, did you or did you not hurt me? You know, if you hurt me, do I look hurt to you? Yeah, you look hurt. Then you hurt me. So don't say, if I hurt you, I'm sorry. No. Say, I hurt you. I did this. I said that. Okay, be very honest, very open about it, okay? I said whatever, and say what it is, okay? Then you start with the second part. It was sinful. Not it was a mistake. Okay, mistakes is where you didn't carry the one when you're doing math. Mistakes is when you confuse there, and there. Illusion, illusion, exclude, include. That's a mistake. Okay, when you offend someone, when you insult someone, when you spoke sinfully against someone, when you sinned against someone, that is not a mistake. That is sin. You sinned against them. I don't think God would look at it very nicely if you went, sorry, you know what, God, I know Jesus died on the cross, but, you know, my mistake. No, it's not a mistake. It is a complete, absolute sin. So how this begins going is, I did, fill in the blank, it was sin. I sinned. It was absolutely wrong. Because here's the thing, if you don't admit that it's sin, if you don't admit that it's wrong, why would you ever change? Why would you even give any indication that what you did was not appropriate? Why would you ever try to do anything different unless you know and can admit that you shouldn't have done it in the first place? So admit it fully. I did blank and it was absolutely sinful. And by the way, by doing this, it eliminates the but apologies. The but apologies are, sure, I did this, but you. Okay? That's another. Do you see how many ways we try to blame shift? If I, you first, you make me, but I did this, but you. How many times do we have to shift that? It's like Adam's sin still sits in us. Oh, by the way, it does. Okay, so this eliminates that but type apologies. Okay, I did blank, it was sinful. Now you can say, I am sorry. People like to start here. They like to start at step 3 and skip 1 and 2. And what that really does, it makes it a board game apology. Clump, 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 sorry. This is, we're not talking about dice and pieces on a board. We're talking about a human being here. We're talking about the image of God. We're talking about someone that God created out of his own image to represent and reflect him. How we treat people is, in a sense, how we are treating God. In fact, if a person is saved and they are a fellow Christian, you know what? That means then that their body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And whatever temple of the Holy Spirit exists, that means that the name of God rests within that person. So how you treat that Christian is how you're responding to that third commandment, do not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. You treat a Christian poorly, you break the third commandment because you're offending his name, because his name rests within the Christian. See, it's not so much about verbality, is it? Okay, so I did blank, it was sin, and I'm sorry. Okay, I recognize I should not have done. In fact, sometimes I like to tell people in counseling sessions within that sorry, I don't have it on the list here, so just kind of do a little arrow with this. It would be, you know, do something like I should have done, I should have said. Because whenever somebody comes into counseling, usually it means that they're under a habit. They can't figure out how to break. So then I try to instruct them, go through this, but then ask, what should you have done instead? How should have you have responded instead? And then say that with it. I said this. It was sinful. I should not have said that. I am sorry. I should have said this or responded in this way or just not said anything at all because I was having a hard time controlling my thoughts and my emotions. Should have just been silent. Okay, whatever the case is, what would you have done, should have done differently? And then it brings us to the last one. Will you forgive me? Will you forgive me? This step facilitates reconciliation. This step allows a relationship to begin to heal and is necessary. A lot of times people will just say, I'm sorry, and then they just let it go like a board game. They don't even come back to it. They don't do steps 1 and 2, and they definitely don't do 4. Will you forgive me? When you say, will you forgive me, what you're asking of that other person is to no longer hold it against you, no longer to bring it up, not to you, no longer to bring it up, not on Facebook, not to friends, not on Twitter, not in a text message, not in an email, okay, no longer, not over drinks at a restaurant with your sisters or your brothers or whomever. You don't bring it up. You don't talk to anyone about it because it's gone. You let it go. Okay, so you don't constantly bring it up. You don't dwell on it. You don't let it mull in your thoughts over and over again. You decide to go ahead and follow 2 Corinthians 10:5 that says you will allow and you will not dwell and you will capture every thought for Christ. And you don't hold that sin against them anymore. Now, let me just offer real quick here, just because I understand that we all come from diverse backgrounds and we all come from weird little scenarios, there are rare exceptions of extreme abuse, of things like that, to where when you say, when they come up to you, there was a gal that I had talked to that from the age of 5 until the age of 15, her father went into her bedroom almost every night and raped her. Okay, now that father comes up to her at the age of 17 and says, I did all that and I'm sorry, it was sinful, will you forgive me? There's going to be consequences that are going to hang on to that. It's not just it is completely deleted and gone. There are consequences there that father A should go to jail and B should never be responsible for babysitting a child ever. Okay, there are consequences that should be in play. And so what I'd like to at least offer that this is a general scenario for the average daily bustles of life. There are very rare, maybe 0.some% circumstances that are very rare. We hear about them a lot only because of the news, and we got like 300 million people. And if only 0.5% had anything bad happen to them, that means we're hearing about it a million times. Okay, so we hear a lot about these horrible cases when they are very much the rare exception. So don't let those rare exceptions say we get to delete all of this. And don't think that just because you're personally really upset about something that you fit into that rare exception. Because odds are you don't. Okay, and so I just kind of want to point that out. And if you are someone who has been molested or has been raped or anything along those lines, or someone came and they killed your parents, whatever the cases of extremities like that, I just would like to, from a counseling perspective, to say turn to Psalm 55 and allow the first 15 verses to be your voice. Okay, Psalm 55 is one of those verses where those, or one of those chapters where the first 15 verses is almost like it's the song of someone crying out in extreme pain, but it's the voice of that girl whose dad came into her bedroom every night. It's the voice of that teenage prom queen who was forced into the back seat of a car. It's the voice of a guy whose girlfriend says, "I'm going to get rid of my baby. I don't care what you say." It's the voice of so many people. So allow that passage to speak to you. And keep in mind, we still have to offer forgiveness. Keep in mind, we still have to be able to say, "I forgive you, and I'm not going to keep bringing it up anymore." It doesn't mean consequences aren't there, but forgiveness still can be offered and should be offered, even in extreme circumstances. It is harder, and it takes longer and a lot more time. But let me just completely offer this. Yes, there are situations to where the words "I'm sorry" carry very little meaning because our hurt is so deep. And it is so drastic. And at the same time, it is minuscule in comparison to what put Jesus onto the cross. It is still part of this broken world, and Jesus still died for them as well. And so we do need to offer out that forgiveness and that restoration. It is the church that is supposed to be that prime example, tangible, practical, sink your teeth into example for this world to see people be agents of reconciliation and healing. And if the church can't be a place of healing, then where can be? And so the only way that we are ever going to be able to allow our nation to begin to see that healing is possible, forgiveness is possible, restoration is possible, it has to start here. It has to start with each one of us individually. So the question I get to leave you with is, what role are you going to play in showing this world that healing is possible? What role are you going to play? Are you going to have vengeance? You're going to seek to harm the other person? Just cut them out of your life? You're going to try to insult them worse than they insulted you? Cost them their job? What are you going to do? Or is it going to be you're going to allow justice to be justice and you're still going to forgive and not hold it against them anymore and try to rebuild and restore the relationship as much as it can possibly be rebuilt? If we're going to be a nation of reconciliation, it has to start with the church. And I fear that the church is doing a lousy job because they can't even figure out how to go to a homosexual and say, "I love you." All they can do is spout out the sin that's there when we all have sin as well. And someone showed us love first. We have got to learn to show love to people, even sinners, because aren't we all? So we got to get there. We got to show that it starts with Jesus, not with morality, not with ethics. It starts with Jesus. That's where forgiveness starts. That's where restoration starts. That's where healing starts. Are we willing to go there? Let's have a word of prayer.